life more than the blessing that God gave us after the trouble. For we focus on the hurt instead of focusing on we ain't with the person that hurt us. We focus on not having money, but yet we don't realize that God keeps waking us up every day, giving us opportunities to try and make more money. And in fact, if the truth would be told, most of you in here that's dealing with trouble in your life, I really wish you would testify and tell the truth that you had more good days than you had bad days. But the problem is that you worry more about your bad days than you do your good days.
Yes, sir.
For you can have a great day and something small happen to you, glimpse through your mind, and you'll take that good day and ruin it because of something you used to remember. The problem with most of us is we haven't laid a stone where our problems were delivered from, so that when we have something to look at, we can say, I remember when, but I ain't gonna stay there. I remember when I didn't have no food, but I can't stop there. I remember when I didn't have no job, but look where I am right now. I remember when I didn't have two nickels to rub together, but look how God has blessed me. When you are to remember, you are to remember where God has brought you from. You are not to remember and get stuck there. You are not to cry over past hurt. You ain't supposed to get caught up in past pain. You ought to be able to look back where you come from and shout that you're not there anymore. You shouldn't worry about whether or not people understand your tears, understand your joy. You ought to shout because you remember a time when you couldn't, when you were robbing Peter to pay Paul, and now you ain't got to rob nobody because God has blessed you and all your bills is paid on time. All your household is paid. Your car is running good, but yet we focus on bad stuff. Well, I would like to get into what has been going on in Facebook, and everybody keeps sending me these messages about the young boy or what has happened in Euclid, and I really feel bad for what has transpired in Euclid, and I'm going to deal with that a little bit later on, but that's not the issue of my sermon today, because we really need to realize we need to remember from whence we came, and when we remember from whence we came, our ancestors had to go through that garbage, our forefathers had to go through that garbage, but we should have been smart enough now that we shouldn't have to go through that garbage. Something needs to happen where we need to change the way our children think. And that's something on a whole other day. But look in the text in Joshua, the chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. The children of Israel had been held in bondage in Egypt under Pharaoh's reign. Moses had negotiated their release, and with God's help, he set them free. And then while they were going through the desert, and they were spending some 40 years in the desert as Moses as their leader, finally Moses is getting ready to die, and now Joshua is in charge. For Joshua's in charge of taking them to the other side, or taking them over into the promised land. Yes, while they were going through it, what they were going through, it was hot in that desert. It was a dry place in that desert. It was very uncomfortable in that desert. And yes, while they were going through it, they had glimpses of the promised land, of this beautiful place that they can have that was promised to them, but yet they couldn't get there. For while they were thinking about this dry place, yet here they come to the brink of Jordan. And you would think that they would be shouting because here they are walking in the wilderness for 40 days. God had to feed them with quail and manna, and yet here's some water. And you would think people would have been shouting that there was water there, that they didn't have to wait on manna to fall from heaven. They didn't have to wait on God to send birds through the desert. But yet here's a river that fish may be in there. Now I can jump in, I can drink some water now. I can jump in and there's fish in here and I can eat. But yet they were concentrating on whether or not how they're going to get to the promised land, because here's this river. They cross. And oftentimes we can't shout because we got something else in view instead of what's in front. And here they are in the Jordan, and the text says that the Lord begins to talk to Joshua and tell Joshua, get you 12 men.
Yes, sir.
And tell these 12 men to reach down in the midst of a river and grab 12 rocks. You need to know today that if I was one of the men, I would be upset. Because those rocks were not small rocks. For they had to be big enough rocks for the people to be able to see it from the seashore. So it had to be big enough so that here they are carrying these rocks for some people that ain't even satisfied. Can I pause for the pause real quick? Have you ever found yourself doing stuff for some people in your family and they ain't never satisfied with what you done? You work 80 hours a week, did your best, the light bill paid, the gas bill paid, but yet they want something different. Have you ever encountered some selfish people that ain't never happy with nothing? You do for them. You put pork chops, but yet they want chicken. You cook chicken, now they want meatloaf. Okay, you want to act funny. Ladies in here, have you ever cooked something for your man and he act like he wasn't happy with what you do?
No.
You done vacuum you. You done wash down the windows and he come home and say, you mean to tell me my dinner? I'm trying to start no fight, but I'm trying to get you to understand where I'm trying to go. There are people, no matter what you do, ain't never satisfied with what you do. And you have to get to the point in your life where you quit worrying about whether or not they satisfied and do the best that you can do with what you got. You may not want no pork chops, baby, but pork chops is what you're going to get. You don't want that, then you might as well go in the kitchen and cook something new. And what's crazy today is we give our kids so many choices. I'm trying to figure out when did we go from doing what I say do instead of doing whatever you want to do. Because there was a time we could not go to McDonald's when mama done cooked. There was a time when mama bought tennis shoes. They may have been slip and slides. They may have been to the grocery store. But you won't put them shoes out of your hands on your feet until they can do. So he told them to take up 12 stones and drop it in the water for a memorial from which you came. And so here they are. And this is where I want to drop my anchor, because I want to tell you three things and then we're gone. The first thing I want to tell you is you got to remember when he brought you out. You got to remember when he brought you up. And then lastly, you got to remember when he brought you through. The problem with most of us is we don't remember when he brought us up. There was some days you couldn't afford to go to JCPenney. There was some days you couldn't afford. Oh, okay, let me help y'all out. There was some days you couldn't go and hit these giant tigers was your friend. There was days you had to go to Grove Circle and Sam's because there was no other store that you could go in. But now you can walk in the mall and buy whatever you want to buy. You can remember those days, but you ought to thank God for where you are right now, because Grove Circle and Sam's stuff didn't last. But now you can buy some stuff that lasts a little while longer. Is there anybody in here that don't mind testifying that you were so glad that God blessed you with a job you were only making $2.50? But now look at you. God got you in double digits. Will you please high five your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I remember when God brought you. who gave us the ability to produce wealth. So therefore, I may not have had a job. I got one now. It may not be what I wanted to be. It may not be the kind of job I wanted to be. If I got a flip burgers, they're going to be the best flip burgers in the place until God can take me where he wants me to be. I ain't got to go in there every day with an attitude. I ought to be thankful that I got somewhere to hit the clock. I wish we had more people that were just happy with what God is doing. Yeah. And learn how to be satisfied. Yeah. Until he gets you somewhere better. Uh-huh. See, what we need to remember, first of all, God ain't really got to do nothing for none of us. But he does it out of his grace and his mercy. That he looked beyond our fault and blessed us anyway. Some of us have jobs we know we don't even deserve to have. But look how God has brought us. Some of us got diplomas and we can't read 3 days in hell. But yet God still blessed us. The second thing is, not only do you need to remember when he brought you up, the second thing you need to remember is when he brought you out.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 1:26-30 says, brother, think what you were when he called you. Not many of us, I'm reading from the NIV, I'm sorry. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influenced. Not many were noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of this world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of this world to shame the strong. Oh, I need to put a PM right there. There's a whole lot of people in here that ain't got a college degree. Wow. That's a whole lot smarter than us with degrees. They know how to manage their money. They didn't have to go to no class. They know how to get stuff done. Right. And God said he chose them to make us wise people look stupid. Verse 28, I could go on, but I don't want to stay there. I got to get to where I'm trying to get. Verse 28 says, and he chose the lowly things of this world, that and despised things, and the things that are not, to nullify the things that are, or to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast of himself. You ain't doing what you're doing because you're doing it. So what, you pay the gas bill? God designed you to pay the gas bill. God designed you to pay the house note. God designed you to drive that truck. He didn't design her to drive no truck. She ain't built to drive no truck. She's built to look cute. Why are you tripping? Because you got to drive the truck. She ain't built to cut no grass. You built to cut the grass. Go out there. Y'all can't hear Rev Jackson back here. I said, no idea, cut that grass. I ain't do it. And it is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who have become for us wisdom from God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. You ain't done nothing for God to save you. So what, you read the Bible from cover to cover? It's by his grace that you are saved. And if he didn't want to save you, you'd still be lost in the song. But you got to learn how to be thankful for where God has brought you from. Quit boasting about what you've done. God can take your mind and you won't be able to remember all the books you read. God can take your health and you won't care about none of the stuff you read. But it's because of his grace and his mercy that kept looking beyond my fault, that he kept my mind at perfect peace. You see, when he bring you, he brought you up. Not only did he bring you out, but he brought you through.
Yes.
Yes. I can stop right there, put a pin right there, and we can go on home. You know, we all have been through a whole lot of battles. My battle may not have been your battle, but you went through a battle. Somebody here battling because they had to bury their child. Somebody battling because they lost their job. There's some of us in here, you don't even know, that's battling with cancer. Some of us have battled with divorce and bankruptcy. There's somebody in here that's been battling with molestation, battling with rejection, loneliness, abandonment issues, and even broken hearts. But I need to tell you today that while you're going through all of the battles that you're going through, you need to remember that God is taking you through the battle and not leaving you in the battle. It wasn't designed to destroy you. Bankruptcy didn't stop you. The drugs didn't stop you. Divorce didn't stop you. It didn't destroy you. You kept on moving. You kept on going through. And you ought to praise God that God let you go through it and didn't let you stop in it. Because if you had to stop in it, you wouldn't have made it through. Is there anybody in here that God might testify that you was going through the valley of the shadow of death, but God made a way out of no way for you and took you through the mess, that when you got on the other side, you said, if it had not been for the Lord, that was on my side. I don't know where. Will you hop out your neighbor and tell your neighbor, baby, you don't know what I've been through. And I don't look like what I've been through, but I'm so glad God kept me while I was going through it. Is there anybody in here that don't mind shouting that God has been leading you time after time, time after time, time after time, time after time? I wanted to give up, but he kept me. I wanted to throw in the towel, but he threw it right back at me. Will you please help out your other neighbor and tell your other neighbor, I'm so glad Jesus got it all. Destroy you. It didn't take you out. It just guided you through. What God wanted to do was he wanted to take you on a tour ride.
Amen.
Have anybody in here ever been on Line in the Trolley?
Yes.
On Line in the Trolley. You get in on one destination.
Yes, sir.
And they take you through the city and show you what used to be where certain stuff is now. And if you get the right driver on Line in the Trolley, he will play the music for you as you're riding through. Oh, y'all ain't feeling me, but I'm about to mess somebody up. When you find yourself going through what you're going through, you ought to get you a Line in the Trolley mentality. You ought to put some music on. I don't care what your music is. I don't care what you like to listen to. And you need to look at what was and what is now. And you need to shout where God has took you from. And then you need to say, I rode my line in the trolley today. I wanted to cry, but look what God has done for me. I wanted to give up, but line in the trolley, trolley in the trolley, right? Line in the trolley. When you see somebody going through what they're going through, you need to tell them to take a ride through your line in the trolley. Because on your ride, there was some heartache on your ride. There was some destruction on your ride. There was some brokenness on your ride. There was things you could eat on that ride. But when you got off the line of the trolley, you were able to eat a little bit. You were able to pay a little bit of bills. And matter of fact, you're smiling now more than you ever smiled.
Amen.
I got you out here. Thank you for your time. I didn't mean to hold you that long. But let me just share this with you. My family makes fun of me because I like to watch the Hallmark Channel. But see, I can sit there and I can watch the Hallmark Channel from the time I get up to the time it's going back to bed. I know the programming so well that starting in July, it's called Christmas in July. Yeah. They play all the new Christmas movies before October the 10th get here, because on October the 10th, they start playing all of them all the way through Christmas. I'm sorry, to January the 1st. But after January the 1st, I really don't watch it after Christmas. Because then I go to Lifetime. But watch this. So here it is. They make fun of me because I watch all the romantic movies. I watch all of the spring movies. And then after their villain, I watch Columbo. I watch Heart to Heart. And I watch Madman. The same segment five or six times, and it really don't matter. I watch them as if I watched them for the first time, even though I've seen them five or six times already. So when they come in the house and I'm sitting in my chair in the front room, they smack their lips, they make fun of me. But what they don't know is the reason why I watch these movies the way I watch these movies is because I was a child whose grandparents and their aunts and their uncles, my mother didn't take me on trips, but my aunts, my uncles, and my grandmother did. I was one of them people, watch this, who were taught by their uncle how to work on cars and how to fix a car they told you not to buy, but because I bought it anyway, they felt sorry for me and they taught me how to work on. I was that kid at 18, didn't have nowhere to live, didn't know where I was going to stay, and had a baby on the way. And everybody was looking at me like I was the scum of the earth. I was that child at 25 that didn't know how he was going to feed his family. And a deaconess of the church took picnic food from the church and brought it to me so I could feed my family to a check. I was that person that was in an abusive marriage that when it looked like I did everything I thought I could do. I worked three jobs. I bought everything I thought it was. And still, the abuse of the relationship was so bad that people were blaming me. So when I sit down and I watch those movies because toward the end of the movie, it shows that person's life getting better. And it makes me realize that God has something in store for what I was going through. Now I'm the uncle that gives aid to the people. Now I'm the one that's working on people's cars for them. Now I'm the one that's sending people checks until check to get them. So now, people looking at me now, and they say, man, you got it going on. But I remember when. I remember every stone that I had to lay, every tear I had to cry, every river I had to cross to get where I am now. What are you trying to say, Reverend? All I'm trying to say to you today is, hang on in there. Don't give up. Don't give in. Don't worry about what people say. God got a blessing for you. The promise. The Bible said that when Joshua and them crossed that river, they dropped the stones in there. And watch this. He said, don't just think about it for yourself. He said, tell your children of how you made it over. So when your children get the trip and talking about, you didn't buy them no Jordans. You need to tell them, I remember what I did, buy you what I had, what I got. When your husband say, you ain't doing what you done, you need to tell him, I remember when you couldn't wash your own. that they got what they got. Oh! What I'm so glad is, watch this, is that we got a cross that we can remember. That when we look at the cross of Calvary, we got something that we can remember. I know they talk about what Jesus, where they nailed his hands and they nailed his feet, and he said, I dare you to lift me up. If you lift me up, I'll drop. And then they talk about him going and being laid in a bald man's tomb. And on the third day, he got up with all power in his hands. And everybody shout over that, and that's wonderful. And that's great, and that's a part of the gospel. But the part they leave out is he's coming back. And I need to tell you today, you need to remember that when he went to Calvary Cross, he's coming back for you. Do you have your ticket? Are you in your life? If you got your ticket, stand on your feet. Tell your neighbor, I got my ticket. I wait on him to come back. I may not be what I want to be. I may not have what I want to have. But I got my ticket in my hand. I'll make it rule over me. With head bowed and eyes closed. Maybe you're here today.